Hello, I'm Glenn Cowan from Concordia University. In this, the second video, we're going to look at an important analysis technique for analog, RF, and mixed signal circuits. That is, small signal analysis. I hope you enjoy it. Please feel free to contact me if you have any questions about the material. Let's get started. In these slides, we're going to review AC small signal analysis. In the previous video, we looked at the DC operating point and calculations on the DC IV characteristic of MOSFETs. Here, we're going to apply those IV characteristics to AC small signal analysis. Before we get started, though, we want to be clear on some signal naming conventions. So, shown in this slide is a sine wave superimposed on a DC offset. We'll use the lowercase name and the uppercase subscript here to denote the total quantity. So this will refer to signals as a function of time, and it will be the entire signal, both the time-varying component and the DC offset. We'll use the uppercase name and the uppercase subscript to denote the DC quantity, or the average value of the signal. And we'll use the lowercase name, lowercase subscript, here little I, little d, to denote the signal component. So this is the component that is varying with time, and it's typically the component that is containing the information in whatever system we're designing. In some cases, when we're looking at the frequency response of a system, we'll use the uppercase variable name, lowercase subscript, to refer to the amplitude of an AC quantity. So to recap, uppercase variable, uppercase subscript, DC, average value. Lowercase variable, uppercase subscript, total quantity. That's the quantity you'd measure on a scope if you were measuring the quantity with DC coupling. And then the variable, or the small signal quantity, is the lowercase variable, lowercase subscript. So clearly, we can write this total quantity as the sum of the DC quantity and the AC quantity, or the signal quantity. Okay, so we're going to go through a motivation for small signal analysis before jumping into the model and the equations. So this is the common source amplifier we looked at, or the common source configuration we looked at in the DC calculations in the previous video. Let's suppose we want to find the output voltage here for a given input voltage. In this case, the input voltage has been written as a DC quantity plus a 100 millivolt sinusoid. So let's try to write the output voltage as a function of the input. And then we could look at it in this particular case, or we could ask some other questions. So if we have the output voltage as a function of the input voltage, we could ask, what is the voltage gain? And this voltage gain might be a function of the operating point, as we'll see. We could ask ourselves, where is the gain the highest? We could also look at choosing a point on that voltage in to voltage out characteristic where the output voltage swing might be maximized. So in order to derive this relationship, and this relationship is called a voltage transfer characteristic, we'll use these quantities. So we'll use a VDD of 3 volts, a resistance of 1 kilo ohm, a W over L ratio of 10, and a mu n C aux of 300 microamps per volt squared. We'll denote the combined mu n C aux W over L as Kn, and in this case, by multiplying the 10 times 300, we have 3 milliamps per volt squared. Let's assume the transistor is in saturation, and in doing so, we can write the following two equations. So the first equation here is a KVL type of equation relating V out here to VDD minus the IR drop across this resistor. So the output voltage depends on the drain current. The drain current then we can write, assuming the transistor is in saturation, as 1/2 Kn Vi, that's VGS, minus VT quantity squared. We're going to ignore lambda, ignore channel-length modulation here, because when we have a MOSFET biased to VDD through a resistor, the channel-length modulation effects are usually quite small, and it will make the analysis quite a bit more complex, at least for hand analysis. So I can substitute the second equation into the first equation and write it in this fashion, where I have VDD minus R times this expression for the current. We could plot that output voltage, and I did so using Excel. So what we've got here in black is the output voltage as a function of the input voltage. Now, this black curve is really just plotted for, or at least for input voltages greater than half a volt, I'm plotting this expression. For input voltages less than half a volt, I'm saying, the transistor's not on, the current is zero. If the current's zero, the output voltage is equal to VDD. I'm not explicitly plotting this voltage equation here for input voltages less than half a volt. So what we have is we have this downward sloping characteristic where for small input voltages, we have virtually no current and the output voltage is equal to VDD. Then as the voltage increases, the input voltage increases, the output voltage decreases. And the slope is always negative. And the magnitude of that slope is increasing as we increase the input voltage. I've also plotted this burgundy line here. And this burgundy line here is the line that represents the boundary between saturation and triode. This is the VGS is equal to VDS plus VT, or let me write it here. This is VDS is equal to VGS minus VT. And that represents the boundary between triode and saturation. Up here, when the output voltage VO, VDS, is larger than VGS minus VT, we're in saturation. And then down here, we're in triode. So the quadratic expression that has been derived is only valid up in this region here. If it predicts an output voltage less than the boundary, then we would have to go back, revisit it, and write the current voltage characteristic for the MOSFET using the triode region equation. And if we were to do that, we'd see that the characteristic here kind of bottoms out. It's going to go something like that. And it's going to, the output voltage is going to approach 0 volts as the transistor goes into deep triode and looks like an increasingly more conductive resistor. Okay, so that's the overall IV characteristic. Let's write the input voltage as the sum of a DC quantity and a signal quantity. And so what we're going to do is we're going to put that into our earlier equation. So I guess we can go straight to this one on the bottom. Vout is equal to all of this. And this is with this, you know, sum of DC and AC squared, and we're kind of going through some of the simplification. So if we look more closely here, this first term here depends only on DC quantities. We have the DC input voltage. The next term has both DC and signal quantities, and it's linear in the signal voltage. And this coefficient that's going to map an input signal to an output signal depends on the DC operating conditions. And that's important because we know that the gains of all these circuits are going to depend on our choice for DC bias voltages, etc. The third term is quadratic in the signal and has no dependence on the DC bias voltage, although it is going to, its effect on the output voltage is going to depend on the W over L ratio of the transistor, which is embedded in this Kn term. So let's rework this a little bit. So here we have the DC voltage. This is 1/2 Kn DC voltage minus VT squared. That's going to give us a DC current here. And that's going to contribute to the DC operating point at the output. I've just rewritten this middle term here, and then I've distributed the kn over here for the quadratic term. If we look more closely at this middle term, we see that this is simply the derivative of current with respect to the input voltage. If we were to go up here and differentiate this expression with respect to the input voltage, we'd bring the 2 down, multiplying against the half, so we'd have kn vn minus vt. And that's what we've got here. And we call that derivative, just following down this middle term here, we call that derivative with respect to VGS, gm, or the transconductance of the transistor. And then we've got this squared term here. So when the input voltage signal quantity, lowercase v, lowercase I, is small, this third term is going to be small relative to the first two terms. So let's, for the time being, ignore it. So now, in ignoring this third term here, we have an output term depending on the DC current, and then this term depending on the transconductance of the transistor. Okay, let's try to make an association between the various components of the output and DC and signal quantities. So the output then is formed of a DC term here and a signal term here, depending on the input signal. So we're going to make the output term here, the DC output term here, associated with VDD minus R times ID. We're going to work it through with the numbers that we had for the various parameters on the previous slides. This is going to give us an output DC voltage of 1.5 volts. By coincidence, that's the same DC voltage as we had at the input. But in general, that would not be the case, that it would be the same. The output signal quantity here is given by R times kn vn minus vt, and we'll just plop in the negative sign here. So we end up with an output signal quantity that's 3 times the input signal quantity with this minus sign. So what this means is that when the input signal is going up, the output signal is going down, or we have a 180 degree phase shift between input and output. Let's take a look at voltage gain. This is the output voltage as a function of the input voltage. If we take the derivative of the output voltage with respect to the input voltage, ignoring this higher order term, we get an expression like this. So we have minus R times this GM quantity, which for these parameters, as we already said, evaluates to minus 3. So that means this circuit can be used as an amplifier, and the output signal quantity will be 3 times the magnitude of the input signal quantity with a 180 degree phase shift. These statements, though, are for the case where we have the input DC voltage at 1.5 volts. So based on this notion that gain is equal to the derivative, and based on this voltage transfer characteristic, we can say, where is the gain the highest? Well, the gain is going to be highest when we're still in saturation, but the input DC voltage is such that we're just about to get pushed into triode. So in fact, in this example, this transistor was biased at a point that has almost the most gain. The gain might go up a little bit to get to this point here. Of course, that wouldn't be very practical for two reasons. The first is that for any non-trivial output signal swing, the transistor would go into triode and the actual voltage transfer characteristic would level out quite a bit. And the second is that it might be hard to control that bias point so that we were reliably at this point and not down here where the actual voltage transfer characteristic would level out. Where is the swing maximized? So output swing is going to be related to the vertical axis here. So the output can move up and down here. And so we're going to want to bias the transistor somewhere in this region so that the output could go all the way up to VDD and all the way down to this point here. And that would be the point that would give us maximum output voltage swing. So this situation is fairly common in that the bias choice for maximum gain is different from the biasing choice to maximize the output signal swing. Now, these slides are still titled motivation. And so the point that we want to take away from this is that we can find things like gain, we can find output signals due to input signals, if we make use of the large signal equations. So these are the equations like, you know, ID is equal to some constant times VGS minus VT squared. It can be difficult to include lambda in some of the hand analysis, and these nonlinear equations are very difficult to solve if we have more than one MOSFET in the mix. The solution then, in order to find quantities like gain, input resistance, output resistance, when we have more complex circuits, is to linearize the circuit around a particular operating point and to use an AC small signal model. Once we linearize the circuit, we can fall back on matrix methods for solving the linear equations that we'll get by writing, you know, mesh and nodal equations. So let's take a look at the small signal model of the NMOS. This is the model that we're going to use in this work. So we've got a couple of elements here. We have a voltage-controlled current source here and a resistor here. This voltage-controlled current source produces a current that flows between drain and source, and it's controlled by the gate source voltage. The value of this voltage-controlled current source, or GM, is going to be computed as the derivative of the drain current with respect to gate source voltage. So this is the slope of the characteristic, the nonlinear characteristic of ID versus VGS. So this is shown here. So ID versus VGS. Now here, this VGS is the total VGS. We know that it starts out close to zero for VGS less than a threshold, and it goes up something like this. So at some particular point, if we know the transistor is operating with a DC gate source voltage here, then the GM is the slope of this line. That's a perfectly drawn straight line here. Centered around this point, we'll call Q, the quiescent point. So the slope of that line is the GM. So that gives an accurate representation of, well, how much extra current flows due to small fluctuations in gate source voltage here. This output resistor models changes in drain current due to changes in VDS. So let's think about it in terms of a conductance for now. So GDS is the derivative of the drain current with respect to VDS. Again, around a bias point Q. So the large signal current, the large signal behavior, I'll sketch here. So we're in triode initially, goes up, kind of levels off, increases like that. So GDS is the slope of the tangent here. Again, we'll call this point Q. The slope over here is GM, and the very shallow slope here is GDS. Okay, so this small signal model, this configuration, works for modern short channel transistors. We may need to add other parasitic elements to get the model to work at very high frequency, but the general idea, there's an RO and a GM, holds. What will be different, though, from a modern short channel device will be the expressions for those parameters. So here we have the expression for the drain current for a long channel MOSFET, taking into account lambda or channel length modulation. If we differentiate this with respect to VGS, we'll get this expression here. And then we can rework this in conjunction with the original nonlinear IV relationship to get these two expressions here. The reason why we want to have these multiple expressions is it can be motivating to think about how various changes will change the transconductance. And we'll talk more about that in a later slide. And then if we differentiate the ID versus the voltages with respect to VDS, we'll get this relationship here. So RO is 1 over lambda ID. And again, lambda depends on the length. So the length is sort of built into this lambda expression. Okay, so how do we get a big GM? Oftentimes we want more gain. We saw in the last expression, that in the last couple slides, that gain depended on GM. So if we want to have a big GM, well, how do we make it big? Well, we could increase the width for the same VGS, and we'd get a GM that's proportional to width. We'd also get a current that's proportional to width. If we have a fixed width and length, and we increase the current somehow, that would be associated with changes in VGS, but we'd get GM would increase with the square root of ID. If we look at this last expression, and we say, how do we get a big GM? Well, it looks like if we could come up with a way to make the overdrive voltage small for a given current, we could make GM arbitrarily big. So this third equation implies that GM can go to infinity if I can make VGS minus VT go to zero. And we could do that by letting the width go to infinity. Now, is this really possible? Well, of course, letting the width go to infinity might be impractical, but there are other limitations. These relationships have been derived for the square law model. And we know that if we make the current per unit width, current density, get really small, and VGS minus VT get really small, so VGS is getting close to VT, the transistor is going to enter weak inversion. The square law model is no longer valid. And so we can't get an infinite GM by making the width get arbitrarily big. It will saturate to a value that would correspond to as if we made this denominator equal to about 100 millivolts. Now, for high-speed design, making the width get very large tends to be impractical because making the transistor width very large can lead to large parasitic capacitances. And so pushing the transistor to these high GM modes of operation is not typically going to be done in high-speed design. Okay, we have a model for an NMOS transistor. Of course, we want to have a small signal model for a PMOS transistor. So let's consider the saturation region IV characteristic, so and this reference direction for ID. So this is the saturation IV characteristic. Remember, we got this by putting absolute value bars around VT. So maybe just to make that unambiguous, VT for a PMOS is a negative quantity, so we'll put the absolute value bars here. And then we've flipped the polarities of the voltages. For an NMOS, we had VGS. For a PMOS, we're going to have VSG and VSD. So let's modify, as needed, the NMOS small signal model to make it work for this polarity. And when we talk about modifying it, we're talking about, do we have to do anything clever to the polarities of the components? So here is the small signal model for an NMOS transistor. It's flipped upside down, so the source is up here, to be oriented in the same way as the regular schematic symbol, where the source is connected to the higher voltage than the drain. Now remember, this current flows in this direction. The reference direction for current flows this way. So let's check, can we just use the NMOS small signal model without any kind of modification? So, this current here increases if we yank the gate down. If we pull the gate down, if we're at a given bias point, and we pull the gate down a little bit, we get a bigger VSG. So the VSG goes up when we pull the gate down, and that causes a bit more drain current to flow. So, let's see what happens down here. if we pull the gate down, what happens? Well, VGS is less than zero. VSG goes up, VGS goes down, so the signal component for VGS is negative. So that means that if we have a negative VGS here, we get a negative current flowing this way, or we get a positive current flowing this way. And indeed, this model with these polarities here will capture the small signal behavior of the PMOS transistor. So I think it's really great from this point of view of minimizing the amount we need to remember that we have one small signal model for NMOS and PMOS. The difference, of course, is what the anticipated DC voltages are. For an NMOS transistor, we expect a DC VGS greater than zero. For a PMOS transistor, we expect a DC VSG to be greater than zero. But the small signal model is unchanged. Okay, let's look at what the steps to small signal circuit analysis are. The first thing we need to do is to find the DC operating point. And we're usually going to do this by assuming that the MOSFET or MOSFETs are in a particular region of operation. Usually, when we're building an amplifier, we're going to assume that the main amplifier transistor is in saturation. We may have loads that are in triode, but the main amplifying transistor we're going to assume is in saturation. So we solve for the DC operating point. We need to check to make sure that our assumption was correct. Next, we'll draw the small signal equivalent circuit. When we draw the small signal equivalent circuit, this has two aspects. One is to stick in the small signal model and then turn off the DC sources. So what does off mean for a voltage source? If we have a DC voltage source connected to a node in a circuit and we turn it off, that means the voltage is zero for any current. This corresponds to a short circuit. A current source being off means something different. It means the current is zero for any voltage across it. That corresponds to an open circuit. Then we can calculate the small signal parameters using the DC operating point and the equations that we have. Then we'll solve the circuit using KCL, KVL for whatever quantity of interest we're looking for. Now we can swap the order of 3 and 4 if we wish to do some of the computation and analysis symbolically. And in this set of slides, that's what we're going to do, because we want to have an expression as opposed to simply a number. The example we're going to look at is a common gate amplifier. So we've got a MOSFET here, got a resistor to VDD, an output voltage we're going to take here, and we're applying an input voltage here through a capacitor. So I'll mention it now that we're going to assume this capacitor is big, and that for all relevant signal frequencies, it acts like a short. And then we've biased the transistor with a current source here. So let's find the gain and the input resistance. And we'll define what those are as we go. We'll assume this set of parameters. So V bias here is 1.5 volts. We have a current of 1.5 milliamps. And we have a Kn mu ncox W over L of 12 milliamps per volt squared. So the first step was find the DC operating point, assume the MOSFETs are in a particular region of operation, solve and check. So let's assume the MOSFET is in saturation. The drain current is going to be equal to the bias current, because if we were to write a KCL at this node for DC, we'd have no current flowing through the capacitor. So all the current from the current source flows through the MOSFET. So Vout is equal to VDD minus R times ID. That gives us a DC voltage of 1.5 volts. So the DC drain voltage is equal to the gate voltage. It's also 1.5. And therefore, the transistor is in saturation. The output voltage could drop by another half a volt if that's what the threshold voltage is, and we would still be in saturation. To find the DC voltage at the source, we need to figure out the VGS of the transistor. And again, we're ignoring the body effect in these calculations. So we have this expression for V the drain current as a function of the gate source voltage. And we're going to ignore channel length modulation effects here because it's not going to significantly change the results that we're calculating. So we can rearrange this expression to get VGS on the left side, and we'll get a VGS of 1 volt. So VGS, remember, is V gate minus V source, so we can rearrange that expression and get the source voltage to be equal to 0.5 volt. So let's write some of these down here. So this is at 1.5 volts. The gate that was given, 1.5 volts. And the source is equal to 0.5 volts here. Okay. So draw the small signal equivalent circuit. So the gate was connected to V bias. It's a DC source. It's off. Off for a voltage source means V is equal to zero, short circuit. We have the MOSFET here, gate, maybe I'll write that, gate, drain, and source. At the drain, we had this resistance R going up to VDD. That's a DC source. We turn it off. We had a DC current source connected to the source. We turn it off. Current source off means open circuit. And then we have the voltage here. We can leave it as a voltage source or just label the terminals. Let's add the voltage source. Like this, for this part. Okay. We've also short-circuited the voltage source to the source. And we said that was because we're going to assume that the capacitor for the frequencies of interest is large enough that it behaves like a short circuit. So do we need to include RO? This is a common question. When do we bother including the output resistance of the transistor? Well, let's include it. It's not that complicated to include it here. And then as an exercise, you can go back and explore, well, what happens if we don't include it, we do include it, for a certain set of assumptions. So now we're going to solve the circuit using KCL, KVL. Okay, here are some equations. Let's go through them. So I like to write KCL, KVL equations. I think that it's a bit more systematic than some of the more hand-wavy approaches to circuit analysis. So going back to a course like basic circuit analysis, you've learned how to systematically solve circuits, and this is actually not a terribly complicated circuit. So if we were approaching this from a basic circuit analysis point of view, we would say, how many unknown node voltages are there? We would say 1, the drain, because the gate, the source is known. Let's write a KCL equation at that node. So the sum of currents leaving is positive. We have these terms through the R, the RO, through the voltage-controlled current source. So I initially just wrote it as GM times VGS. We're going to come here and we're going to say, oh, but VGS is related to VIN. I can write a KVL equation to find the relationship between VIN and VGS. You may be able to look at this and just say, yeah, I can see that VIN is equal to minus VGS. But if you can't, write a KVL equation. So VIN plus VGS is equal to zero. So I'm going to come here and I'm going to put in minus VIN for the VGS here. I'm also going to write this in terms of conductances. It's a lot easier to recast these equations using conductances rather than resistances because we get fewer fractions in the sets of equations. So now every term is an output or an input, Vout or Vin. So we can rearrange this to get Vout on the left and Vin on the right, and then divide. So the voltage gain is the ratio of Vout over Vin. It's the slope of the line. It's also the ratio of the signal quantities. And if I do that, I'm going to get GM plus GO divided by GO plus G. So we get a lot of terms here. It can be useful to play around with them a bit to put them in a form that makes a bit more sense. If we do this, we can put it in this form here. Now let's take a look at these terms. In the numerator, I have a GM and a GEO. The GM is going to be bigger than the GEO. Even in a nanometer-sized technology, GM is going to be 5 times or so at least bigger than GEO. If it wasn't, inverters wouldn't have enough gain and digital logic would start to fail. So I'm saying the numerator then is pretty much dominated by this term. And then in the denominator, we're assuming that this resistance R is not that big, so that G0 times R is smaller than 1. And so the denominator is dominated by 1. If we do that, then this gain expression simplifies greatly, and we have AV is equal to GM times R. Let's make a couple of observations. The first is that it's greater than 0, meaning it's non-inverting, meaning the signal at the output is not flipped with respect to the signal at the input. The second is this is the same expression as we had for the common source amplifier. So a common gate amplifier, which is what this is, has the same gain form as the common source amplifier. Okay, so let's just substitute in some of these values. So in this work, we have a larger value of Kn, and GM is equal to 6 milliamps per volt, and the overall voltage gain is GM times R, or in this case, it's equal to 6. Okay, let's interpret these results a little bit. So what does it mean to have a gain of 6? So suppose Vin is equal to 1.5 volts plus 0.05 volts times some sinusoid. So find Vs and find Vout. Okay, so let's sketch each of these quantities. So up here, let's start with Vin. So I'm going to plot the total input voltage. This may not be entirely to scale. The point we want to stress is Vin has a DC operating point of 1.5 volts. So I'll draw this dashed line across here. And this is, of course, time. So we've got a small sinusoid here. And the amplitude here, you know, peak to peak, is 0.1 volts. Then we've got Vs. So Vs has a DC operating point that's different. Vs has a DC voltage of 0.5 volts. So it's got the same signal because it's coupled to Vin through that capacitor, but the DC operating point is significantly lower. But it's the same small amplitude. So I'll draw it like that. 0.1 volts is the peak-to-peak voltage. And that's centered around 0.5 volts. Then Vout has the DC voltage that we already derived. And that's up here. It was 1.5 volts, but now the signal is bigger. It's 6 times bigger, so it's going to look something like this. And now that peak-to-peak quantity here is 0.6 volts, and notice it's in phase with the input. So when the input goes up, the output goes up too. So we always want to remember that even though we can get off into small signal analysis land, at the end of the day, there's a total voltage at each node that's composed of a DC quantity and an AC quantity. When we plot transient voltages in a computer simulator, we're going to see the total quantity. When we measure a signal voltage with a scope in DC coupling, we're going to see the total signal quantity. Okay, let's take a look at input resistance. So input resistance is defined as the signal input voltage, or the signal voltage divided by the signal current. So let's make a note that it's really important that we notice that these are signal quantities. So there's three ways to calculate the input resistance for this circuit. We'll start with the most complicated and drop down to the least complicated. So the most complicated would be to apply a test source here at the input and then write nodal equations for the unknown node voltages, Vout and Vin, and then find the ratio between Vin and In, and that would be the input resistance. The second way would be to apply a test voltage source at the input, and then we have to figure out the input current. So we could find out the input current by maybe finding the output voltage, and we'd have Vin, we'd have Vout, so we'd know how much current flows through the voltage-controlled current source and how much current flows through the resistance RO. We could add them up and then get the total input current and find the input resistance. A somewhat more clever way, and so we'll do a mix of brute force analysis and cleverness. The more clever way is to recognize that the input current here, whatever current flows here, it splits. Some goes here, some goes here, but the same current flows here. So In also flows there. And if we do that, if we know the output voltage, we know the current flowing into that resistor, and therefore we also know the current flowing in over here on the left. So we can write Vout, Vin over In as the multiplication of these two ratios, Vin over Vout, Vout over In. So if we were to multiply these things, the Vouts would disappear. So we'll leave this first term here as Vin over Vout. Then we just said here that these two currents are the same. So really, I can write this first term as Vout over Iout, which is what we have here. So this first term, Vin over Vout, is 1 over the gain. Remember, the gain is Vout over Vin. Then this second term, Vout over Iout, Iout's flowing this way into this resistor, Vout's the voltage across the resistor, so Vout over Iout is just the resistance value R. So we have the expression for the gain from the previous slide. We're going to multiply by R. So we're going to get rid of these R's in the denominator. Making some of the same assumptions as we made before, we can see that this expression will effectively drop down to 1 over GM. So we think of GM as being a big conductance. It's the conductance that provides the gain. So we usually think of a common gate amplifier as having a low input resistance. And for these particular values, it would be 167 ohms. And that's fairly low when we think of the fact that the resistance here was 1 kilo ohm. Okay, it's important for us to get a good handle on what is large signal analysis, what small signal analysis, what are they each good for. So on the top left here is a generic amplifier block, an input voltage and an output voltage. And let's say we have a voltage transfer characteristic as what's shown here. So this voltage transfer characteristic would be derived using large signal analysis. So large signal analysis can give us the whole picture. It uses the full model. By full model, I mean the full IV characteristics of the model, which is typically nonlinear. We need to use these sorts of models if we want to come up with estimates for the amount of distortion. Distortion is caused by those higher order terms that we got rid of when we did small signal analysis. Large signal analysis is more accurate than small signal analysis, but because it's more computationally intensive, it's slower to do both for humans and computers. Small signal analysis, on the other hand, uses small signal models. These are linearizations of models that were used in large signal analysis. So once the circuit's linear, the computational techniques are faster. We can solve linear equations using matrix techniques much more quickly than we can solve nonlinear equations. And again, this is true for both humans and computers. We use small signal analysis to find small signal gain, input resistance, output resistance, and things of that sort. It's faster. Okay, in summary, small signal models are the linearization of nonlinear equations around an operating point. We need to find the operating point in order to find model parameter values. The expressions for parameters, for small signal parameters, assume a particular model. But in general, they boil down to derivatives of measurable IV characteristics. When doing small signal analysis, we need to shut off the DC sources. So that means voltage sources go to zero, short circuits. Current sources go to zero, open circuits. We're going to insert the small signal model and solve the circuit. If you have any questions, please do not hesitate to send me an email, gcowan@ece.concordia.ca. Thanks for paying attention.